Yes.
Two short questions. One, when we had the temperatures when it's going to have to be in the ice age, what time frame did that swing between the back of the pool?
Because we made it in the ice field.
Yeah.
Well, there's been very careful analysis of that, and the length of the entire cycle, so, would be something like between 1,400 and 1,500 years, that's the average. And so these cap cycles are more like 700 years. And I mean, runs were claimed that these are very regular, and that would be based by the sun or something, or the water. I don't think there's enough of them to make that, you know, to have enough data to really say that for sure.
And then the technical, the market's greater, your CO2 temperature charts show a pretty good spike resistance in 100 times the light version of whatever those cycles are. So the last yellow and the red is below the previous peak, so it looks like there's more room in the market.
By the way, let's go back to that. There's no CO2 changes at 12 hours. CO2 is low all over the field. So these are so fast that maybe five parts of the other things, but nothing like the CO2 between peak energy ratio and the heat ratio is about 90 parts per million. So it's a big change. And methane does change. There's methane, there's less than the methane in the atmosphere in only 20 years. So it's really, whatever you see in the reference of methane is pretty much instantaneous production. Most of the CO2 in the system is stored in the ocean. 16 times more carbon in the ocean than in the atmosphere. And therefore, it's spent a little buffer. And to make large changes that fast would be very difficult. In fact, we still don't really understand the CO2 that's so low in the ocean. I'm convinced that it's so much, but there's a number of ways to play that game. I think the record is extremely low, it's causing the ocean.
Yeah. Do you believe the glacial melt that you tell that in Greenland has an effect on the Atlantic conveyor by changing the salt density?
Yeah, if Greenland were to fall apart quickly, it would stop the conveyor. But people, even with the current, you know, signs that Greenland is doing some strange things, people still think that too. Melt all of Greenland, even if we raise the CO2 up to 700, 800 parts per million, it would take hundreds of years. So it would be a long-term, very expensive thing because it would destroy all coastal property in the world. Greenland is holds equivalent of 7 meters of sea level, so 21 feet around the world, but obviously wipe out all of the known property now, plus a few countries to Google. But that would be very slow. One thing I think is that I'm a big proponent of taking CO2 back out of the air, which is something that was demonstrated by Klaus Lochner, his local bureau, by actually the global bureau and all that stuff. And if you could do that, I think it's going to be necessary if we ever stabilize the CO2 content. Once you have that, you can also use it not only to take out what you're producing, but you can take out more than you're producing and post that down again. So we're going to do this experiment where we're going to see how Earth climate depends on CO2 content. It can take a long time to shut it down. 50 years is the minimum. And during that 50 years, you get some idea of what climate is like. And you may decide you want to run it back down again. And certainly, if there's a fear that we're going to destabilize Greenland, by running it back down again, we're really kind of removing the lessening of threat from Greenland, the lessening of rate. And of course, you could bring it all the way down to pre-industrial eventually, and that would maybe allow Greenland to start to grow again. But, you know, it's starting to get into the sense climate in the unit, whether we like it or not, because we're going to have to decide of the CO2 content of the atmosphere to agree after to get it under control.
Yeah. Would you think it's about energy input? It's like a lot of energy input to remove the CO2 from the atmosphere when you come into the.
Well,
and that in itself produces more CO2?
It would.
I mean, put it in some energy in order to take CO2 out of the atmosphere.
Oh, we have to put it some.
Yeah, I mean, I've got some energy to do that, and that in itself would.
If the energy to do that is more than 20% of the energy that you got by burning the fuel in the first place, you're in trouble. So this whole thing has to, that's the thing that has to be proved, that you can do it without using so much energy. Things like ethanol, the energy required to produce the ethanol we put in our cars is about between 0.9 and 1.1 the energy we get back out of it. And if that's true, that's useless.
Even a quarter of a switch rate or something like that.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Storing CO2, I haven't had a chance to go back, but I did hear lately that people off at MIT had said that storing CO2 at the bottom of the ocean.
The funny place.
Well, I'm asking you. I heard that notion. I'm asking you what you think the utility of that, and what would be the independent relationship of storing back in CO2 on the ocean floor, which we know very little about.
Well, right now, Greenpeace would prevent any serious study of that. I mean, a serious study would involve experiments. I got a phone call promise from them that I want to discuss with them this whole thing. I think putting it in the deep ocean is one of the better places to put it. It's not the only place. Complicated evidence of global commerce. But it's going to go there anyway. If we just stop right now, something like 30% of the CO2 we release goes into the ocean. If we were there, if the ocean would be able to emit really rapidly, it would take up 5/6, or take up a hell of a lot more than it has. But the mixing of the ocean is slow, and so it takes hundreds of years. So we would. Eventually, it's going to get down there. One advantage of putting it down there purposefully, if that were the only place you could put it, is that it would saw the top off the big peak, so we're going to go up and see or two, and then the system itself is going to bring it back down again by putting it in the deep ocean. We could saw that peak off by pumping it down there ahead of time. You could short circuit the mixer. What has to be done is to find out, of course, when you put it in, if you're putting it in a quince down the sea floor, it will become a flat rate compound, 7 waters and 1 CO2, and there's a slush down there that will gradually develop. Rates we don't know, but I would guess rates on the other decades, and it would spread across the deep sea. Once it's spread, it's okay. Then what would have to be said is what kind of local damage would it do? Well, no environmental problem is not going to have side effects. We don't seem to get awfully concerned with threats from slaughtering the fish on the top of the ocean. And I would say, in any worst case calculation, even if the fish down there chose to commit suicide and stuff, and every one of them in those areas died, we wouldn't kill more than 1% of the fish down there. So, if you're worried about fish, you should worry about the upstairs fish.
And where's the other location? You said it's not in the bottom of the sea, someplace else. Where would that be?
Well, you can put it in saline reservoirs and under the continents. That has an advantage that you're putting your CO2 in your own national territory. And that water down there is useless. It's got far more salt than the ocean, so we're not going to use it for it. You want to desalinate seawater. Japan could not do that. So they had to ship their CO2 to China or something, which would get rid of it.